Now we'll discuss some important questions for CTET EVS paper 2. First question, which of the following set comprises liquids which are poor conductors of electricity? Here four options are given. Among this we have to identify which are the combinations of poor conductors of electricity. Okay, look at the option here. Tap water, shampoo, honey. As we know, shampoo is a poor conductor of electricity. There is no free electrons there, so it won't conduct. It's a poor conductor. Honey is also, it's like a sugar solution. So here also there is no any free ions to conduct. So these two are poor conductors of electricity. But consider the first term, that is tap water. Tap water, actually we know pure water is a poor conductor of electricity. It won't conduct easily, but tap water cannot be considered as a pure water. So it is a conductor of electricity. It's a good conductor of electricity. So this combination cannot be the combination of poor conductors. Now look at the second option, salt solution, lemon juice and vinegar. Here salt solution, there are NaCl ions in the case of salt solution, or in the other salt there are corresponding positive and negative ions there. So it cannot be a poor conductor, it's a good conductor of electricity. So anyway this option won't be there. And the, when we consider the other two also, lemon juice and vinegar, both are acids. Acids are good conductors of electricity. Acids and bases are good conductors of electricity. So in this option, no any poor conductor is there. All are good conductors. Now in the third question, shampoo, vegetable oil, distilled water. Here, shampoo is a poor conductor of electricity. Vegetable oil is also a poor conductor of electricity. It conducts little bit. Vegetable oil conducts little bit, but it's a poor conductor. Distilled water, it's a pure form of water, so this also won't conduct. So among this, all are poor conductors of electricity. So this will be the correct option. Then when we look at the fourth option, sugar solution, vinegar and lemon juice. Again, all these are conductors of electricity. So here option 3 is the correct answer. Shampoo, vegetable oil and distilled water are poor conductors of electricity. Now look at the second question, which of the following set comprises chemical changes? We know there are two types of changes, chemical changes and physical changes. Chemical changes means that cannot be reversed or any change in the matter happens there, a new substance will be formed there. And physical change means changes are reversible, and rather than that, new substances are not formed in the case of physical changes. Now among this option, boiling of water is a physical change. There is no any new substance formed there. Only a change of state happens though. Breaking of glass, there also no new substances are formed. Rusting of iron, in the case of rusting of iron, new substances are formed. Iron will react with oxygen and new substances are formed in this case. So first two are physical changes here, and only the third one is a chemical change. We have to select an option in which all the three are chemical changes. So this cannot be the option. Now second one, dissolving salt in water. There also no any new substances are formed. Digestion of food, it's a chemical change. Here new substances are formed after digestion. Next, shredding of paper. Here also there is no new substances formed. So anyway, here also it is not the chemical change. Only the digestion of food is the chemical change. Now the third one, cooking of food. Cooking of food, in that case there are some chemical changes happening. New substances are formed. Boiling of water, there is no any new substance formed. It's a physical change. Dissolving sugar in water, this is also a physical change. So this cannot be the option. Now look at the fourth one, rusting of iron. Iron will react with oxygen and new substance is formed. It's a chemical change. Burning of paper. Paper will react with oxygen and new substances are formed. That is also a chemical change. digestion of food, there also new substances are formed, that is also chemical change. Now in this, all the three are chemical changes, so this will be our option: rusting of iron, burning of paper, digestion of food. All these three are chemical changes. Now our third question: Nina was cycling to the market to buy some grocery items. The market is 4 km away from her home. She travels at a speed of 12 km per hour for the first 10 minutes. On her way, she meets her friend Nikhat and stops to chat with her for 15 minutes. She resumes her journey at a speed of 8 km per hour. What is her average speed for the journey? So, the equation is simple. Average speed, we have to calculate the average speed. Average speed is equal to total distance covered by total time. So average speed is equal to total distance divided by total time. Okay, here total distance, we know the market is 4 km away from her home. So the total distance will be 4 km. But in between, she stops for some time. So the time we have to calculate and substitute there. Okay. So here look at this condition. Suppose this is the home and this is the market. Okay. The distance between home and market is 4 km. This is the starting point and this is the ending point. She travels at a speed of 12 km per hour for the first 10 minutes. In first 10 minutes, she travels at a speed of 12 km per hour. So we don't know up to where she traveled in this 10 minutes. This 10 minutes is the first time here, T1. Okay. So we can calculate at what distance she is now after 10 minutes. So for that, speed is equal to distance divided by time. So here distance will be equal to speed multiplied by time. Here speed is 12 kilometer per hour and time is 10 minutes. This is in minute, this is in hour. So either 12 kilometer per hour we have to convert into 12 kilometer per minute, otherwise 10 minutes we have to convert into hour. That is easy here. Now the speed is 12 kilometer, so 12 multiplied by time. Time is 10 minute. So to convert minute to hour, have to divide by 60. So here 10 divided by 60. This is the total distance traveled in the first 10 minute. If we simplify this, 0 and 0 will cancel. 6 and 12 will cancel. The answer is 2 kilometer. So in this 10 minute, she traveled 2 km exactly at the center. So this is 2 km after 10 minutes. Now on her way, she meets her friend and then they chatted for 15 minutes. Okay. So 15 minutes is spent for talking there. So this is the second time T2. Okay. So first 10 minutes, then after that 15 minutes. Then she resumes her journey at a speed of 8 km per hour. That is the remaining 2 km she traveled in a speed of 8 km per hour. But we don't know the time she's taken to travel this distance. So time we can calculate here. Here as we know, speed is equal to distance by time. So time is equal to distance by speed. So here time is equal to distance is remaining 2 km. So 2 divided by speed. Speed is 8 km. On simplifying it, it will be 1 by 4 hour. Okay. Now we can add the total time here. This will be T3, the remaining time. With that, she reached at the market. So time 1 is 10 minutes. Time 2 is 15 minutes for talking. And after that, time 3 is 1 by 4 hour. Okay, for the remaining journey. Now, we know the total distance, that is 4 km. total time we have to calculate. So total time is equal to T1 plus T2 plus T3, that is 10 minute in hour, that is 10 by 60 plus 15 minute, that is 15 by 60 plus the remaining time 1 by 4 hour. Okay, so we can convert that into minute. So it will be easy for the calculation. Otherwise, plus 1 by 4 itself, we can simplify from here. Okay, now on simplification, here LCM can be 60. Here it is 10. Here it is 15. And here it is 15. 15 multiplied by 4 is 60. So 1 multiplied by 15, that is 15. So the total time is equal to 40 divided by 60 hour. Okay, so now we got the total time and total distance, can find out the average speed. Okay, now here average speed is equal to total distance, that is 4 kilometer divided by total time. So divided by 40 by 60 or multiply with the reciprocal, that is equal to 40 into 60 divided by 40. 0 and 0 will cancel, 4 and 4 will cancel. The answer is 6. 6 kilometer per hour. So from this option, option 1, 6 kilometer per hour is the correct answer. Now fourth question, which of the following will not be helpful in the process of separating a mixture of salt and water? We have to separate the combination of salt and water. Here four options are the decantation, filtration, distillation, boiling. If we consider this question, the correct answer for this question is crystallization. That is the method used to separate salt and water. Actually, crystallization is the combination of boiling and distillation. First, we will boil the material, then we will distillate it to make it separate. So, in the answer also, after this exam, the site has given as mark for all, because crystallization answer is not specified here. And both of this part of the crystallization, boiling and distillation, is also given here. And look at the other two consideration. We will consider this method also. Decantation is the method that after sedimentation, the upper part we will separate. That process is known as decantation. Then filtration means filtering by using any of the suitable material. And the other two, now we discuss, it's familiar, okay. Now next question. Which of the following properties of light can be used to explain the phenomenon of shadow formation? In the formation of shadow, which are the properties of light is important? Here four properties of light are given. Light travels in a straight line. All the statements are correct. Light travels in a straight line. Light travels at a high speed. Light is composed of seven colors. Visible light composed of seven colors. Light does not pass through opaque object. All the statements are correct, but to explain the shadow formation, which are the phenomenon we need? Okay, we know that if there is a source of light, suppose this is a source of light, if there is one object here, there is one object here, light will spread out everywhere, but it cannot pass through opaque object. Light will pass only to the transparent object. So light cannot pass through this object. Okay. And also light travels in a straight line. That's why it cannot bend and go. It will pass directly. And wherever there are opaque object, it cannot pass through that region. That's why there is a shadow behind this objects we can see. Okay. So among this, the two options. Light travels in a straight line, so it cannot bend and go. Okay, so there is shadow behind the, and light not passes through opaque object. It can pass only through transparent object. That is, we can see that for the transparent object there won't be shadow, only for opaque object there will be shadow. So these two properties of light is used to explain the shadow formation. The other two properties are correct, but not to explain the shadow formation. So from this, A and D are correct. So option 4, A and D. Now next question, identify the correct statement from among the following. The proportion of fine particle in sandy soil is relatively higher than in the clay soil. The amount of large and fine particle is about the same in clay soil. The proportion of large particle in loamy soil is relatively higher than in the sandy soil. The proportion of fine particle in clay soil is relatively higher than in the loamy soil. So about three soils are discussed here. Number one is sandy soil. As the name suggests, it is composed of sand, very big particles. Second one is clay soil. Okay, in the clay soil, as the name suggests, it is composed of clay. That is the very fine particle, very small particles. Loamy soil. Loamy soil is actually the combination of those two, sandy soil and clay soil. There will be clay in that, sand in that. Okay, bigger particles are there as well as smaller particles are there. So in the case of structure, the size of the particle, sandy soil will be composed of a big particle, loamy soil after that, then a clay soil is the fine particle, is the smallest one. Here the size of the particle is compared here. In the first one, the proportion of fine particle in sandy soil is higher. That is wrong. Okay. Actually, in sandy soil, the amount of large particle is higher, not fine particle. The second one, amount of large and fine particle is about the same in clay soil. Okay. In clay soil, there is no large particle, only fine particles are there. Third one, the proportion of large particle in loamy soil is relatively higher than sandy soil. Actually, in sandy soil, large particle is there, not in than loamy soil. So this is also wrong. Fourth one, the proportion of fine particle in clay soil is relatively higher than loamy soil. This is the correct option. Fine particle, the smaller particles are more in clay soil than in loamy soil. Look at the next question. Deficiency of vitamin X causes bleeding of gums. This vitamin is essential for the absorption of mineral Y and X is found in food Z. Identify X, Y and Z. So here, deficiency of vitamin X causes bleeding of gums. So first we have to identify which vitamin's deficiency causes bleeding of gums. As we know, that is vitamin C. Vitamin C's deficiency causes bleeding gums. So here X vitamin D cannot be X vitamin C. No any other option with X vitamin C. So this could be the correct answer. Okay. So X is vitamin C. Vitamin C's deficiency causes bleeding of gums. Now this vitamin, we can check for the other also. This this vitamin is essential for the absorption of mineral Y. Okay. Iron is necessary for the absorption of vitamin C, and we have to identify the food in which food is Z in which this vitamin present. Okay, as we all know, citrus fruits like orange etc. is rich in vitamin C. So here that option itself is given, Z as the citrus fruit. So this is the correct option here. Now next question, which of the following statement best describes the nature of science? This is actually from the pedagogy part related to EVS. Which of the following statement best describes the nature of science? The nature of science is described by science is a system of beliefs. That is wrong. It is not only belief, there are experiments, proof, etc. Science is social in nature. Could be one of the correct answers. Science is social in nature. It's always considered the society. Scientists are totally objective in their work. That cannot be. Okay. There should be in between. The work cannot be totally objective always. The scientific method is only guide for conducting research. This is also wrong. Scientific method is not only the guide. There are many other methods also. The research itself are of different types are the. So here the option 2. Science is social in nature. That is the correct answer here. Comparing all the three. Next one. Cognitive validity in science curriculum means. What is mean by cognitive validity? So look at the option. Inclusion of how concepts of science evolve over time. Adaption of concept as per the cognitive level of learners. Dilution of the content. Inclusion of the appropriate fun elements of science. Out of all this, when we are making a curriculum, always we have to consider the learner, not the other aspects of the subject. So here, second option says about the learner, adaption of content as per the cognitive level of learners. According to the age of the children and the cognitive level only, we should make the curriculum. So option 2 is the correct answer here. Now the last question. According to NCF 2005, in the upper primary stage science curriculum, which of the following is recommended? Here, four options are the, which of the following is recommended? First one, concept should be linked to making sense of everyday experience. Whatever we teach, students should feel that is needed for their everyday life. Okay, or whatever we study is needed for their life. So one of the aim should be this one. Second one, concept should be arrived at from activities or experiments. Students have to find the concept to develop the concept by themselves, not by direct teaching. They have to find it themselves. So by activities and experiments, they should develop it themselves. Third one, concept should be taught through disciplinary approach. It should not be done. We should not teach any topic by disciplinary approach, but rather than in a friendly manner through experiment and activities, we have to introduce a lesson. Now, along with concepts, laws and theories need to be introduced. That is also, it's not a good thing here. So, first two options A and B should be adopted here. So, in our options, A and B are the correct answer. Here, this option 2 says it is A and B. So, option 2 is the correct answer here.